So one of the common complaints I hear from sceptics of the energy transition is this point about national grid operators taking very heavy spinning turbines out of commission as fossil fuel-fired power stations are replaced by increasingly large quantities of renewable power generators like wind turbines and solar panels. Those large, heavy spinning turbines play a vital role in traditional centralised grid systems because they provide something called inertia. Imagine a giant heavy flywheel spinning steadily. It's hard to stop or speed up quickly. And that's exactly the point. In traditional grids, the spinning turbines inside coal, gas, hydro or nuclear power stations act exactly like flywheels. Their large rotating mass stores kinetic energy, which helps resist sudden changes in frequency when something unexpected happens, like a power plant tripping offline or a factory suddenly switching on. That inertia gives grid operators a crucial buffer, buying them a few seconds to adjust supply or demand before the frequency drifts too far from its target, which is something we'll learn a bit more about later in the video. Without that stabilizing effect, even small disturbances can cause big problems like blackouts or damage to equipment. So how are grid engineers proposing to replace that crucial safety measure once all the steam and gas turbines have gone? Well, yeah. It's a problem. Or is it? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. So, grid frequency then. Well, along with grid voltage, it dictates the safety and stability of all electrical grid systems that use alternating current, or AC, which as far as I know, is all of them. I'm sure you've seen videos about Edison and Tesla and the battle between AC and DC, or direct current. So I won't traipse over that ground again. Suffice to say, AC has the distinct advantage that its voltage can be stepped up or down easily using transformers, which made it ideal for building large-scale transmission networks. That's because AC naturally creates a changing magnetic field, which is needed to induce current in the secondary coil of a transformer. DC doesn't do that on its own, at least not without power electronics anyway, because it lacks the continuous variation in polarity that generates electromagnetic induction. You get a brilliant alternating current from a turbine spinning an electrical generator, and you can keep that turbine rotating using a steady jet of gas or high-pressure steam produced by boiling water, whether using a nuclear reaction, a gas turbine, or a coal-fired furnace. You can do the same thing with a hydroelectric plant, of course, and there are some very lucky countries with the right geographical features that are able to run their grids partially, or in some cases almost entirely, on that resource. But for everyone else, it's looking increasingly like wind and solar are going to be the preferred options when it comes to renewables. Now, you could certainly describe a wind turbine as a very heavy, spinny thing, couldn't you? So surely that gives you AC power and inertia, right? Well, sort of yes and no. But before we get into that, if you're liking what you're watching so far, don't forget to subscribe to the channel and hit all notifications so you won't miss any of my weekly videos. Now, it is true to say that a wind turbine generates AC power as a result of the rotation of the blades, but unlike traditional power station turbines, which are spun at a tightly controlled and constant speed using a steady stream of fuel or steam, wind turbines are at the mercy of the changing wind speeds. That means the frequency and voltage of the AC they produce are also constantly changing. If you fed that kind of variable frequency current straight into the grid, you'd really mess up the grid frequency, which would be bad. So in practice, most modern wind turbines first convert the variable AC they produce into DC, that's called rectification, and then they convert it back into grid-compatible AC using an inverter. The inverter ensures that the output is synchronized to the grid at the correct frequency, either 50 or 60 times per second, depending on the country, as measured in hertz, 60 hertz in the US and 50 hertz in much of Europe, Asia and Australia. The output from a solar panel is always direct current, of course, because there's nothing spinning there. It's just a constant stream of electrons being liberated by photons of light hitting the panel. So that output also needs to be fed through an inverter to convert it to alternating current. So what happens when those newfangled, predominantly renewables-based grids suffer a sudden unexpected variation, like high winds or a lightning strike taking out a solar park, or maybe a large industrial facility ramping up its demand? You won't have the big, heavy spinning turbines anymore, will you? So how do you keep the frequency at safe levels and prevent blackouts or damage to sensitive equipment? Well, for a start, there's utility-scale battery energy storage systems. They're brilliant at detecting frequency deviations and injecting or absorbing power within milliseconds, which really helps stabilise the grid by smoothing out sudden fluctuations. Or you could physically replace the inertia provided by turbines by literally installing heavy flywheels in their place. They're already operational on some grid systems, storing kinetic energy and dumping or absorbing power almost instantly in response to frequency changes. Both those elements are proving to be extremely useful in modern, increasingly variable grids. The trouble with both of them, though, is that they only help if the grid is already there. In other words, there has to be an already existing stable voltage and frequency signal for them to react to. And here's where we start getting into the technical weeds, I'm afraid. Most batteries and flywheels use what the industry bods refer to as grid following inverters to act as the interface between them and the grid. They're called grid following because they monitor the existing grid waveform, or sine wave if you like, and then copy it to make sure everything is nicely synchronized. No brownouts, no blackouts, no damage to critical infrastructure. Happy days. Unless, of course, there is no sine wave to work with in the first place, like if the grid goes dark or becomes unstable. Then they don't know what to do. In traditional systems, operators might still have to put one or two zones into a power cut temporarily to keep things stable, but they could always fire up more turbines and generators quite quickly to get things back on an even keel, usually within just a few minutes. Grid following inverters can't do that, so in that blackout scenario, you'd potentially have all your expensive wind turbines, solar panels and batteries all sitting idle and none of your customers getting power at all. The solution to that conundrum, according to the clever electrical engineering boffins, is a device called a grid forming inverter. Unlike grid following inverters that wait for someone else to set the rhythm, grid forming inverters can start that rhythm themselves. They don't need a pre-existing frequency to latch onto. They can generate a voltage and frequency just like an old school spinning generator used to do. In practical terms, that means if part of the grid blacks out, a battery with a grid forming inverter could restart it from scratch, something the engineers call black start capability. And once it's up and running, other generators like wind or solar can sync to it and join in. That means they can form the grid. Even better, multiple grid forming inverters can work together, coordinating their output to create a stable virtual grid made entirely of inverter-based renewables. That's something grid following inverters just can't do. So what's the secret sauce then? I mean, why do grid forming inverters work where grid following inverters fail? Well, apparently it's not so much in the way they're constructed or how the electronics are laid out, although there are apparently some design tweaks. It's much more to do with the control systems, by which I mean the software algorithms that govern how the inverter behaves. A grid following inverter is a passive responder that uses something called a phase locked loop, or PLL, to detect an existing grid sine wave and lock onto it. If there's no sine wave, then the PLL is lost and useless. A grid forming inverter uses what are known as virtual oscillator controls or droop control algorithms to mimic the behaviour of a spinning generator. Those controls can not only maintain a constant voltage and frequency on their own, they can also respond to changes in load like a real world generator would, and they can set the pace for other generators to follow. Some of the newer battery installations in places like Australia and the UK are already trialling this tech. In South Australia, for example, the Hornsdale Power Reserve, also known as the Tesla Big Battery, was upgraded to provide not just energy storage, but also synthetic inertia and grid-forming services. It's now capable of supplying around 15% of the state's inertia needs without burning a drop of fuel. So while grid-forming inverters might sound like a niche bit of engineering kit, they're actually a fundamental part of making high renewables grids reliable and resilient, which is kind of important, don't you think? I'd love to hear your thoughts on these things though, especially if you happen to be one of the engineers working on them. Are they as good as they're cracked up to be? Or have you encountered issues with them that we haven't talked about today? Either way, let me know your thoughts in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. If you enjoyed the information in this video and found it useful, then please do consider subscribing to the channel and clicking on all notifications so that you won't miss any of my weekly episodes. And you can also join the amazing group of folks over at Patreon who keep the lights on around here and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. You can get there by going to patreon.com/justhaveathink or by following the link in the description section below. Or if you're watching on a tablet, smartphone, PC or Mac, you can get there by clicking this link, and you can subscribe to the channel absolutely for free by clicking here. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week and remember to just have a think. See you next week.